Good morning, everyone. What a beautiful morning it is. I'm Dwayne Douglas, Interim Dean, and on behalf of the faculty, staff, and administration of Southern Illinois University School of Dental Medicine, I welcome you to the commencement ceremony for the class of 2022. Graduates, you are a special group of people. During the last 4 years, you've put in many hard hours and distinguished yourselves through academic achievements, the high quality of dental care you've delivered, your community outreach and service efforts, and your research accomplishments. You've also demonstrated resolve and resiliency as we stepped into and negotiated through an unknown realm of the pandemic. In June 2020, you returned to your patient care at the School of Dental Medicine, a full 14 months before most students returned to in-classroom instruction. You returned to treat patients in one of the most highly contagious environments for COVID-19, and I might add, without the aid and protection of a vaccine, which wouldn't come for 7 months. However, before you could do that, you had to finish up your simulation training. Odds and evens took on a whole new meaning. To maintain a safe distance, we had to divide the class up into two groups and teach the curriculum twice, once to each group. You'll probably never forget your bench number, odd or even, because your schedule became dependent on it. Odds got up at 8 in the morning, evens got up at 10, odds finished first, evens finished later. You'll probably never forget whether you're odd or even. In fact, let me have a show of hands. Who is odd? Who is even? Today you're no longer odds and evens. Your doctors. Today, I'm no longer Dr. Douglas. To you, I'm Dwayne. Today, you're no longer Colton or Adam or Megan. To me, you're Dr. Hunter, Dr. Tim, or Dr. Haney. You made it through a gauntlet of unprecedented change in dental education. You're all doctors. Today, we share our pride of the class of 22. Please join me in a round of applause to acknowledge their hard work and many accomplishments. I'd now like to introduce our platform guests. Please hold your applause until all are introduced. Representing the Southern Illinois University system, Dr. Sheila Caldwell. Dr. Caldwell is the Vice President for Anti-Racism, Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion, and the Chief Diversity Officer. SIUE Chancellor Dr. James T. Miner. SIU Provost and Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs, Dr. Denise Cobb. Our 2022 commencement speaker, Dr. Kathleen O'Loughlin. President of the Dental School Alumni Association, Dr. Rebecca Dunn. Associate Dean for Academic Affairs, Dr. Sunny Drictinus. Assistant Dean for Admissions and Student Services, Dr. Cornell Thomas. Our graduation marshals for today's program are Assistant Dean for Clinical Affairs, Dr. Kathy Schaefer, and the President of Faculty Assembly, Dr. Vince Rapini. Will all platform members and marshals please rise if they're able to do so to be recognized? It is through hard work, dedication, and commitment of the School of Dental Medicine faculty that our students are able to achieve academic and clinical excellence. My fellow faculty of the School of Dental Medicine, please rise if you're able to do so and be recognized. A special thanks also goes out to our administrative staff, particularly Rachel Jones, and our dental student ushers for organizing and participating in today's event. It is now my privilege to introduce Dr. James T. Miner. Dr. Miner began his appointment as SIUE's 10th chancellor on March 1st. A recognized thought leader in the field of higher education, Dr. Miner has a noted resume of teaching and scholarship in educational policy, administration in higher education, academic governance, and more. Dr. Miner's bold leadership is propelling the university forward as he develops a collective focus on student success, supporting and enhancing faculty excellence, and engaging donors and community partners to advance regional impact. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Miner.
Good morning. Thank you, Dr. Douglas, and thank you especially to the families and the friends joining us here to celebrate our School of Dental Medicine class of 2022. Also want to welcome everyone to SIUE's Edwardsville campus and to the doctors of dental medicine. I want to begin by acknowledging the additional challenges you've had to face, especially these last 2 years, as Dr. Douglas mentioned, while being odds and evens, which was a new term for me, and starting your clinics even as the world was being battered by a pandemic and we moved to remote learning. But you're here today, and you're leaving us today as dentists, researchers, and accomplished professionals. Now, some of you may have heard Commencement is truly my favorite holiday, and it is a privilege to share this milestone in your personal and academic journey. Graduates, without question, you all have put in the work, you've put in the effort, but you did not make it to this commencement ceremony alone. Take just a moment to remember those who are surrounding you today, and remember that they have invested in you. They recognized your potential and your talent, maybe even before you did, and they have supported you along your academic journey. There's an acclaimed author, David Sean Hutchinson, who encourages us, and I quote, "Don't get so focused on where you're going that you forget the people you're traveling with. There's no point in reaching a destination," he argues, "if you arrive alone." Graduates, please take time today and consistently going forward to recognize and thank the people around you for the important roles that they have played in you receiving that special hood today. Now, for those of you who may be here, you may or may not know, there's a special distinguishing quality for this class of 2022. The graduating class sitting before you accomplished a 100% first-time pass rate on the Integrated National Board Dental Exam. Would you please give them a round of applause? No, really, give them an applause. This accomplishment continues that distinction for the second year in a row for the School of Dental Medicine. This is truly a remarkable achievement. Class of 2022, it has been our privilege to serve you. None of us could have predicted that our lives would have been changed in so many ways due to a global pandemic, but there is, I believe, a valuable lesson for you and for us about the inevitability of change. Life is, I hear an amen over here, life is, after all about change. So as you go forward, I encourage you to expect change. I encourage you to embrace change, to anticipate change, to induce change in the interest of becoming a better professional, a better human being, and the best demonstration of the power of an educated citizen. Congratulations on your wonderful accomplishment, and thank you for choosing SIUE.
Will all the candidates for doctoral degrees from the School of Dental Medicine please rise? Chancellor Minor, on behalf of the School of Dental Medicine, it is my honor to present these candidates to you, who, subject to completion of all requirements established by the University and the School of Dental Medicine, are recommended to you for the formal conferring of their respective degree.
Upon the recommendation of the School of Dental Medicine and by the virtue of the authority vested in me by the Southern Illinois University Board of Trustees, I confer on each of you the doctoral degrees earned with all associated rights, privileges, and responsibilities. Congratulations.
Doctors, please be seated. Administrators, please take your position to hood the doctors of the class of 2022. It has been a tradition of the School of Dental Medicine to allow graduates to be hooded by immediate family members who are alumni or faculty from the school. Six students from the class of 2022 will be hooded by an alumni family member.
Got that, Howard? Good morning. This is a very special time in the lives of our graduates and their guests. We would like to invite family members to take photographs from their seats of your graduate as they cross the stage. Candidates will come to the stage as their names are called. Dr. Noura Abdul Kader Karthik, summa cum laude. Dr. Darush Abhiman, magna cum laude. Dr. Rawawa Abduje, magna cum laude. Dr. Derek Benning, cum laude. Thank you. Dr. Tiffany Blessy, magna cum laude. Dr. Luke J. Brown, magna cum laude. Dr. Brown will be hooded by his wife, Dr. Michelle Brown, from the class of 2021. Dr. James Burris, cum laude. Dr. Bo Byers, magna cum laude. Dr. Shoshana Center, magna cum laude. I do. Congratulations. Dr. Ryan Coliani, cum laude. Dr. Coliani will be hooded by his stepfather, Dr. Mark Todd from the class of 1989. Thank you. Dr. Daisy Cornell, cum laude. Thank you. Yeah, you look great. Dr. Kayla Crane. Dr. Emma Cunningham, cum laude. Dr. Jack Desi, magna cum laude. Dr. Riley Donahoe. Thank you. Dr. Kelly Dudar, magna cum laude. Dr. Joshua Eichelberger, cum laude. Dr. Chino Nyelam O. Iroku. Dr. Samantha Gross, cum laude. Dr. Milana Guadagno, cum laude. Dr. Dylan Hanlon, summa cum laude. Dr. Megan Elizabeth Haney, magna cum laude. Dr. Tabitha Hansen, cum laude. Dr. Colton Hunter. Dr. Taylor Jamolo, cum laude. Dr. Prabhjot Kaur, magna cum laude. Dr. Sora Kim. Dr. Kevin Cordy, magna cum laude.
That's what I do. Are you going to give me your card?
Dr. Anastasia Elizabeth Kozel. Dr. Kozel will be hooded by her father, John Kozel, who's a graduate, who's an associate alumnus and a graduate of Loyola University. Dr. Eric Kubaki, magna cum laude. Dr. Amrit Paul Kular, magna cum laude. Dr. Iodius M. Lee, cum laude. Dr. Allison Long, magna cum laude. Dr. Margaret Latowski, cum laude. Dr. Latowski will be hooded by her brother, Dr. Peter Latowski, who's a graduate of the class of 2013. Dr. Brianna L. MacArthur. Dr. Ravi Prakash S. Mohan, magna cum laude. Dr. Ian Alexander Nickum.
How you doing? Good.
Dr. Shanik Paul, cum laude. Dr. Paul will be hooded by his father, Dr. Arun Paul, from the class of 1991. Dr. Jake Periani. Dr. Zachary Parks, cum laude. Dr. Austin Alexander Petru. Dr. Nicholas Rex.
No soup for you.
Dr. Christian Reynolds. Dr. Patrick Richards, summa cum laude. This is Dr. Richards' sister, Dr. Miranda Ritter, magna cum laude.
I'm impressed.
Dr. Elizabeth Ross, cum laude. Dr. Brendan Smith. Dr. Courtney Jacqueline Smith, cum laude. Dr. Preston Page Street, magna cum laude. Thank you. Dr. Samantha Swoboda, magna cum laude. Dr. Adam Tim, magna cum laude. Dr. Tim will be hooded by his mother-in-law, Dr. Louise First, who's a graduate of the class of 1993. Dr. Parker Upchurch, cum laude. Dr. Thomas Weber, cum laude. Dr. Jacob Wilhelm.
Got it.
And Dr. Paulina Wisniewska, magna cum laude.
That's mine.
Let's give a round of applause once more for these graduates. Thank you. that wasn't for me, it was for them, just in case. It's now my great honor and pleasure to introduce our commencement speaker, Dr. Kathleen O'Loughlin. Dr. Kathy O'Loughlin recently retired after 12 and a half years as the first female executive director of the American Dental Association, the ADA, the nation's leading advocate for oral health. She joined the ADA in 2009 after serving as chief dental officer for United Healthcare Group and as chief executive officer for Delta Dental of Massachusetts. In addition, Dr. O'Loughlin maintained a private practice for over 20 years, as well as a faculty position at Tufts School of Dental Medicine. She is a nationally recognized leader in healthcare, nonprofit, and education sectors, and she speaks around the country about the profession of dentistry, oral healthcare delivery, best governance practices, and public health policy. Dr. O'Loughlin was the first female dental school class president and valedictorian of Tufts University School of Dental Medicine in 1981. Dr. O'Loughlin.
Well, first I want to say to the chancellor, the provost, and the dean, and the faculty of SIU, it's an honor to be invited to this event. Dr. Bitters gave me a call and said, you usually have something interesting to say, so could you please consider coming? And without a doubt, I said, of course, I'll be there. It's a tremendous achievement to receive a doctoral hood. Less than 1% of the entire U.S. population reaches that status. So you deserve to give yourselves a giant woo-hoo, I did it, go ahead. I can't hear you. Yeah, the chancellor and I noticed that this is the only time in all my speaking years that I've ever seen this on the podium. I won't use it, I promise. Okay, so commencement speakers are supposed to have something of interest to say. Some impart, you know, what can I give you that helps you achieve your career goals in some small way. But honestly, all I have is my own story, and I'm going to share some parts of that. And personally, my journey being guided by values and how important values are as you proceed along your life journey, which I expect you to have a 50-year career. Perhaps longer, given the lifespan of this population. So, you know, what are values? It took me a while to uncover what they were. They're those immutable beliefs that you hold that are deeply ingrained in you that really help you make decisions. Whatever values you had when you applied to dental school, some part of those values drove you to make that application and get in and now graduate. And I'll share with you my values and how they helped guide me through this long journey. Since you heard, my graduation date was way before all of you were born, but it's been an interesting life journey. So, first of all, I never attended my own graduation. My husband's sitting over there, and he knows that my oldest son, Stephen, had the great decision to make his entrance into the world at the exact same moment of my graduation. So I went to the hospital, my family went to graduation, and at about midnight, my husband brought me a cupcake from the party that was post-graduation. So, you know, that was a long time ago, and my class reunion was a couple of years ago, and they still refer to him as the class baby. He's a 40-year-old attorney. So whatever happens today, you will remember forever. So I know something about you. I mean, Dr. Bitters and I became close friends. And Vince they were both officers at the ADA when I served as executive director. So I know something about you. First of all, SIU is a top education program. You will be proud of what you know when you are out there in the world practicing. I also know that it's an amazing, diverse class. You were close-knit, you were compassionate. During COVID's worst moments, you held together and you tolerated unpredictability and change. Every day was different. You didn't know what to expect. You didn't even know if you could expect to graduate today and be in person. So I salute your resiliency. I salute your ability to maintain a positive attitude and push through. And your results on the integrated national exam, at the ADA, we expected 10% failure. So kudos to you guys. I have yet to see a class that passed 100%. So that is amazing. You know, I know you had to split into odds and evens. That's hysterically funny. You will be an odd even for the rest of your lives, whether you want to consider that or not. And personally, I think odd is good because it kind of classifies who you really are. Anyway, there should have been another way to describe you. Anyway, you shared laughs and friendship, and you'll hold on to those friendships for the rest of your life. I am still best friends with people I graduated with 40 years ago, so hold on to those. But let me tell you, my personal journey took a lot of twists and turns. There's no straight path in any career. And expect change. As the chancellor said, change is rapid, inevitable. It will never, ever not be facing you with challenges on a day-to-day basis. So, you know, I built a practice from scratch. I practiced over 20 years. My career changed direction when I got a late in career master's in public health. It changed my life forever. I suddenly discovered I wanted to serve populations rather than individual patients, and that diverted me from clinical practice into a broader set of experiences. You know, at the ADA, I was there for nearly 13 years, and I have to tell you, COVID presented enormous challenges to the entire profession. I mean, 206,000 dentists that suddenly had to shut their practices down, had no means of income, didn't know what to do with their staff, didn't know how to apply for loans to keep themselves open, and no answer in sight, no vaccine in sight, no way to know when we would reopen. And through my 40-year career, I have witnessed enormous change, unpredictable change, social unrest, big recessions, small recessions, terrible wars, 10 presidential elections, technological developments that I could not have dreamed of the day I graduated. I've witnessed dramatic changes in the profession over the course of the year. Dr. Bitters and I were talking about this on the way over, how unlikely we could have anticipated self-healing resin restorations, AI, artificial intelligence, you know, being able to print restorations in your office because 3D printing has now become so sophisticated, the use of digital everything. This was totally unanticipated 20, 30 years ago. You too will see change over the next 40, 50 years. Be open to it. Be early adopters. Be inquisitive. Be curious. And don't be frightened of change. Embrace it with your whole heart, because that's the way it is. You know, through all these changes, I learned some key lessons. Let me give you three of them that I think are the most important lessons I've learned. First, be true to your core values. So to do that, you have to uncover them. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. Be kind to everyone always. Always. You never know when your paths will cross again. Always be kind. And be humble and grateful each day, no matter how bad it gets. Get up in the morning and find one thing you can be grateful for. And at the end of the day, find one thing that you can be grateful for. You will be happier as a human being if you can master that skill. You know, I'm always working on my core values. I started uncovering them, I guess, in college, maybe, and that was quite a number of years ago. The most important one to me is integrity, because if you don't have integrity, you don't have much else. I respect people, no matter what level they're at. I treat the guy, you know, the elevator person, the same way I treat the chair of the board of the ADA. I hold myself accountable for what I want to do, and that means measuring my own performance. I accept what comes my way. COVID, I couldn't say I don't want this to happen. I just had to accept it and take a deep breath. Acceptance is really important given the diversity we are facing in our society, and I can't tell you how important that has become. Resiliency and courage are things that I learned and I fine-tuned during COVID, because if I couldn't be resilient, I couldn't lead our profession, I couldn't lead my 500 employees, I couldn't lead the board. And so resiliency and courage, and finally optimism. See the world as half, it's not half empty, it's half full, right? So be optimistic, and sometimes it's really hard. So these values kind of enabled me to reach my goals, and if you have clear-eyed values, they will support you in reaching your goals. You know, a purpose-driven life, it goes way beyond money and things. And our communities, as a professional, expect you to lead with tremendous compassion and empathy and loyalty to their best interests, not your own. And as we all progress, you know, along this life journey, I encourage you to uncover your core values. Whether it's one or 10, write them down, pull them out, and don't feel like they're important when things are going great. They become critically important when things go sour and when life faces some challenges. And I'll talk about some of the challenges that I faced and when my core values kind of kicked in. So during the COVID crisis, and it's still a crisis, it was a very dark time and still is, I discovered that humility and humor really helped my volunteer leaders get through the worst. And the sense of grief everyone was feeling at the normal life that they've lost was overpowering. So my core values, instead of grieving, I kicked in the optimism and the humor and the partying, and we learned how to have social hours on Zoom, which means you could drink different beverages than what you were supposed to drink, because how would they know? You're on Zoom. So anyway, you had to compensate for COVID. COVID also shone an enormous light on healthcare disparities. We cannot tolerate in this society anymore. We are the wealthiest country on earth. We cannot tolerate the have and have nots in healthcare. So pay attention to it and do what you can do as professionals to end the scourge of health inequities in this country. And it means you will only see half of the population in a normal practicing career. You're going to have to go find the other half who don't seek you out and seek them out and treat them. Society gives you this right to self-regulate. And that's why it is an obligation we have to take care of everyone. We have a contract with society and the law to abide by the ADA Code of Ethics, and they're easily found on the website, to always be trusted to do what's in the best interests of our communities and our patients, right? Occasionally, it's going to be hard because you're faced with debt, you've got obligations, you're going to have young kids or families, you're going to find that life has challenges, and you're going to feel a need, you know, for economic security, because that's just the way life is. We all desire that positive return on this investment. We all do. Because you've worked hard, and you've maintained your resiliency and determination, and you should be rewarded for that. But never forget why you came to this school. Economic security wasn't my reason for going to dental school. I wanted to help people. I mean, that was in 1978. And there are times in my life and career where, you know what, I need to take care of myself. So hang on to those core values. You know, my dad was a dentist. He graduated from Tufts, as I did. He was big in our community and a typical community dentist. You know, he coached football and he was active in the church and he was on the public health board and all that stuff. And I worked for him as an assistant when I was in dental school. And even as some of his patients couldn't afford to pay, he kept them and he treated them with the same respect and just hung on to them until life turned around for them. And I can tell you that example led me to lead my practice in that way. My team showed the same respect to every patient coming in the door, whether they could afford us or not. And we always were considered a highly respected practice in my hometown. We delivered top quality care and we had a great reputation. And let's talk about accountability for a minute. You know, just like the St. Louis Cardinals, if you're gonna win, you know, you need to keep score. So how does a dentist keep score? Is it the number of procedures you do? Is it how many dollars you have? Is it the number of staff you have? And I would say to you, it's not counting. It is the impact you have on your patient population. Are they pain-free? Are they disease-free? Can they function? Can they smile? Is an experience with you positive for their psychology? That's the measure of success, not number counting or head counting or dollar counting. And how you measure outcome is possible, With your sophisticated technology in your hands and data in the cloud, you will be able to capture that data and hold yourself accountable for your patient outcomes over the lifetime of a career, and you will be proud at your results. You really will. Trying is the issue, not perfection. I know in dental school we're taught to be perfectionists. There is no perfection anywhere in life, especially in dentistry. And I guarantee you, as you enter practice or wherever your career path takes you, as we all did, you will make mistakes, and hopefully you'll make all of them early in your career, but you will make mistakes. And that's how you learn to be better, okay? 2,000 years ago, Confucius wrote that our greatest glory is not in never failing, but in rising each time we fall. Humility and a fierce resolve to never give up are the most powerful leadership traits you can have. You didn't give up during COVID, so you have an experience around never giving up. Use that and rely on it. And no matter how difficult the task ahead of you is, just never give up. Think of the courage and resilience of the Ukrainian people and what they're going through right now. And they still maintain their dignity and get back to their normal lives, and they move forward, meeting each day. So don't ever give up hope of achieving your dreams and your goals. You know, I personally went through a tragedy when I was in dental school. I was a third-year student, and I wanted to give up. I wanted to walk out of that dental school and never go back. My dad, who I loved and I wanted to be just like him, took his own life in my third year of dental school. He felt isolated and alone, and at that time, you know, depression was not talked about publicly. It wasn't admitted to be anything but a personality defect. I wanted to leave school. I wanted to go back to a nursing career that I had done before entering dental school. But my mentors in the clinic, my role models, especially in the operative dentistry clinic, came to me and said, "You're not walking away, young lady, because you've got too much to give." And they pulled me through that keyhole of grief, and I stayed in dental school and I graduated. And I am still thankful to them for letting me lean on them heavily during the darkest days of my adult life. So if you find yourself losing hope over any issue, get help. Reach out. We all have friends, mentors, sponsors, advisors. Dentists love dentists helping dentists. Lean on us. My email address is available. My phone number. If you ever need me, call me. I give that out to thousands of dental students a year, and I get calls, and it might be a five-minute conversation, but if I personally can help you, if your faculty can help you, if SIU alumni can help you, don't hesitate. And remember, the American Dental Association has your back, and I mean it. So stay involved, join. They are a group you can lean on. Without the ADA during COVID, we would not have been able to reopen dental practices as quickly as we did. The government really believed we would need to just shut down permanently. They don't, to this day, believe that oral health is an integral part of overall health. And so we still have a long way to go before we educate our legislators on how important oral health is to systemic health. As I said before, success is not measured by the number of procedures you do or how much you have in the bank. It's measured by how happy and satisfied you and your families are with your career. That is most important. Success is having loving relationships, family and friends, and to find happiness, return it in kind to all you know. Be kind always. And graduates, my final advice to you is to keep this wonderful profession worthy of respect, uncover those positive values within you that drive us, keep in mind that there are values that are not so helpful. Hubris, self-centeredness, greed, those are the values that will not help you. But find those positive values that you love and feel part of and write them down. I can tell you they saved me from falling off the edge many, many times over my long career. Uncover and grow them now. And don't forget, you don't make this journey alone. Lean on SIU, lean on your alumni, lean on your faculty, lean on each other, and lean on the ADA, and they all stand with you. Good luck in your career, and it's been an honor to speak with you.
Thank you, Dr. Laughlin, for such a poignant, inspiring address. We appreciate your support for the School of Dental Medicine, and particularly these graduates on such a special occasion. And it's true what you said, change is inevitable, growth is optional. It's a tradition of the graduating class of the School of Dental Medicine to choose one of its members to be the class speaker at commencement. It is a pleasure for me to present this year's class speaker, Dr. Eric Kubacki.
I wish for everyone to join me first in an exercise of sorts. I want you all, guests included, to close your eyes. I would like you to take a deep breath in through your nose and now gently exhale out through your mouth. And breathe in through your mouth and out through your nose. We made it. I find it kind of funny that I'm up here right now, as perhaps this would imply I'm exclusively in the know of some great wisdom I am supposed to impart unto you all, or rattle off my special ABC's recipe for success, or some such cookie-cutter commencement speech stuff. I don't intend to do that today, and if it at all starts sounding that way, please feel free to throw tomatoes at me and sharpen your pitchforks. Instead, I'd like to just sort of talk with you all about some random thoughts and feelings I've got floating around in my head. I read once that the average adult has a maximum attention span of about 20 minutes, so I'll make sure to keep the first 20 really deep and meaningful, and the other 40 minutes will be just fluff, I promise. I'm just kidding. I think they actually slotted me 2 hours for this, so I hope everyone went to the restroom beforehand. When I was an undergrad, I loved studying science. Biology, chemistry, it was all very fun and exciting and challenging. But ironically enough, at times, learning about biology, the study of life itself, felt very objective and almost cold. You learn enough about how a tree manages its resources and nutrients, and it starts taking away from the majesty and mystery and beauty of the thing. You learn more about the heart as an electrical pump, and it begins to appear less like something that has anything to do with love. You can make anything seem very complicated the more you investigate it with finer and finer imaging and instruments, or come up with fancy vocab words to describe all its pieces and processes. And studying chemistry, one could argue the building blocks of life, could at times too feel awfully mathematical and dismal. But don't get me wrong, I liked the challenge. I liked that certain questions had concrete feeling answers, and I very much enjoyed the problem-solving and critical thinking aspects. There is something comforting in being able to reach clear conclusions about things and support ideas with evidence. And yet, something was missing. At least it felt that way to me. So as a stress relief, I took a singing lessons class and eventually started singing in the choir. And even though it made me the registrar's worst nightmare, I did credit hour overloads and added a writing minor to my degree, and took poetry classes and creative writing and literary theory. I would hang out at the art studio with my art and photography major friends and really found any way to be around the artsy disciplines. The humanities with its warmth and vitality and open-endedness, those questions without clear answers, balanced out the sciences with their analytical, critical, experimental nature. Both realms, both science and the arts, felt special and significant to me, but I had to have both in my life in balance to feel truly whole. And one of my writing professors, as I was graduating, had this as her farewell message to me: never stop seeing the poetry all around you. She wrote it inside the cover of a blank journal she gave me as a graduation gift. Pretty cheesy phrase, I know, but an extremely invaluable message to keep at the forefront of our minds as we venture forth into the, quote, real world. That is to say, it's an awfully easy trap to become ensnared in to take ourselves rather seriously as dental practitioners. We deal in millimeters and microns, and we're supposed to be tremendously detail-oriented. little type A. We're the bad guys or girls who give people shots, but also the good guys or girls who relieve people of their pain. We diagnose, prognose, can get a little verbose, and make patients near comatose the more we rant and ramble on in our dental jargon. At times, it probably felt on exams or practicals that anything less than a stellar performance was an abysmal failure. Nights spent studying until our eyes bled, hours spent practicing our craft and pushing through lab work with seemingly tighter and tighter deadlines. That kind of academic rigor can start leading to a sort of complacency when we get too hung up on making everything perfect and find ourselves both literally and figuratively staring down the scopes of our magnified loops just a little too much. I think we can become somewhat blind to that poetry all around us. So if I do have any little bit of wisdom I'd like to share with you today, it would be, don't fall prey to the tunnel vision and stop seeing the poetry out there. Don't forget that you can wear a white coat but still have a blue collar. Don't lose sight of that even though now you have extra letters in front of and behind your name, you're still just a first name at the end of the day. When you're going to sleep at night, taking the dog for a walk, or drinking your coffee in the morning. Don't forget that while we do have an important duty as oral healthcare practitioners, it is also just a tooth, and your family, friends, and loved ones would probably appreciate it from time to time that we just stop talking about teeth at the dinner table. All of this being said, I truly feel in my heart of hearts that I chose a genuinely wonderful career, and I hope you all recognize and feel the same, because it's a pretty unique blend of both the sciences and, oddly enough, the humanities. When you really break it down, what it appears to me to be is an amalgamation, pun intended, of a lot of different occupations and roles. We are doctors, first and foremost, but we are also behavioral scientists of sorts, navigating patients' anxieties. And when dealing with the screaming kiddos, it may feel as though we're babysitters or daycare owners. We are carpenters of sorts. We don't use hammers and nails per se, but instead we create and tinker and craft with porcelains and metals and acrylic and resins. We get to be little artists. We polish and shape and sculpt and fret about colors and shades and symmetry and make sincere efforts to make works of beauty. We are dental aestheticians who have the amazing honor and privilege to make people who dislike the way their teeth look start liking their smiles again. I think we all know that warm and fuzzy feeling of having made a patient of ours tear up a little bit by doing something as simple as giving them teeth again with dentures or fixing a chipped tooth in the front that's been bothering them for what felt like forever. So, revel in the nitty-gritty science of our profession. Keep your work evidence-based and rooted in induction by observation and deduction by reasoning. But also have fun with the artistry. Don't forget to laugh every once in a while. Make your patient laugh and not take life nor work too seriously. Truly smell the roses. The past 4 years, and especially the past two, have been much too heavy for all of us. Students, faculty, parents, siblings, family, significant others, and friends alike, to not now feel very light. You've earned this newfound weight off your shoulders. You've but only opened your arms to embrace it. Before I wrap up, I of course have to thank many people. Thank you to my family for being so supportive for my entire life leading up to dental school, and especially for the 4 years throughout. Thank you to my mama for blessing me with her empathy and nurturing nature. I get all my chairside manner from her. Thank you to my father for instilling in me his unyielding work ethic and creative acumen. Thank you to my brilliant brother for the checking in on me phone calls and for your smarts that must have rubbed off on me when we were little. Thank you to all of my professors and mentors under whose guidance and instruction we students were able to flourish and thrive. And thank you to all of my classmates and friends. It's a corny thing to say that without you, I wouldn't have made it, but corny or not, there's truth in it. It was through leaning on one another that we at times stayed standing at all. Both our struggles and victories were and are shared. and I'm honored to call you all colleagues and friends. I leave you now with a bit of spoken word poetry I created in keeping with the theme of my speech, albeit in a literal sense. I was lazy with the title, so it's called Dentistry. Dentistry. Dental school is 100 logies, from Dr. Dixon's radiology to Dr. Costin's cariology, to Dr. Brink's pathology and Dr. McCracken's immunology. We explored anatomy, physiology, microbiology, pharmacology, periodontology. Dr. Hopp, an operative, saying keep those cable surface margins at 90 degrees. You see, we studied, cut crowns, mowed down quizzes and exams like unkempt lawns. The nights were long. Study buddies dragging those too far gone for coffee breaks saying, shake it off, we've got work to do. We got through. We did what we had to do through year one and year two. There was no faking it till you make it, just making the dang Pindex and praying you don't break it. At wit's end, venting to friends, calling our moms, setting denture teeth in dimly lit living rooms with Hulu and or Netflix on. And finally, there we were, walking through the clinic's doors with trepidation not one of us could merely just ignore, with slightly trembling hands, unsure if we were ready, our brains making demands for them to calm, and eventually, they would steady. A whisper of, you've got this, an operatory set up by a friend. The knowledge that after anything worth working towards in this world, there is always a joyful end. Fast forward to boards avoiding eye contact with the proctors. Fast forward again to right now, this very moment, they're calling us doctors. So what makes a good dentist? Here's an easy recipe. Have some empathy. Practice ethically. Behave honestly. Half cup flour, 0 cup sugar. Thank you.
Dr. Kibaki, aside for a couple of Eminem songs, that's about the first rap song I've listened to in a while. Actually listened to. Next, I'd like to introduce Dr. Rebecca Dunn. Dr. Dunn presently serves as the president of the SIU SDM Alumni Council and has been an active member of the council since 2014. Since graduating from SIU SDM class of 1989, she has practiced general dentistry in her solo office in Edwardsville, Illinois. She presently serves as a delegate for the ISDS and on the Madison County Health Department Advisory Committee. Dr. Dunn is an active member of the ADA, the ISDS, the CDS, and the Madison County Dental Society. She loves living in Edwardsville with her family, and you can usually find her running right outside these doors on the beautiful trails within SIUE. In fact, I think this morning she ran a 5K. That's 3 miles for all you folks that don't run. Dr. Dunn, there you are.
Thank you, Dr. Douglas. It's a pleasure to be here today, and congratulations to all of you. On behalf of the School of Dental Medicine Alumni Association, I am happy to welcome you, the members of the class of 2022, into the ranks of graduates of our school and university. From this day forward, Southern Illinois University serves as a tie that binds us together in a fellowship of men and women with a common educational and professional heritage in dentistry. Your association with the university does not end today. It simply changes. As the newest graduates of Southern Illinois University School of Dental Medicine, you are extended the services of the Alumni Association and the opportunity to participate in a variety of alumni programs. Your graduation today signifies that the foundation for your professional life is successfully completed, and we anticipate that from this day forward, Your accomplishments and your achievements will contribute not only to your own success, but also to the greatness of Southern Illinois University School of Dental Medicine. On behalf of the Alumni Association, I extend congratulations. You have our best wishes for success and happiness throughout your lives. I ask the audience to join me one more time in congratulating the class of 2022.
Doctors of the class of 2022, today is a day of celebration. Celebrate completing your studies. Celebrate your new profession. Celebrate your planned success. And as you celebrate these things, remember the following 5 points. Always strive to perform the best dentistry you can do and to continue lifelong pursuit of knowledge and excellence. Treat both your patients and your staff with the utmost respect. Maintain a moral compass, striving to do what is right. Maintain a social conscience. Share your expertise with those less fortunate and who may need your help. Finally, return the love and support to your family and friends, which they have already given you through the efforts and sacrifices they have maintained or they have made in helping you reach the successful completion of your dental degree. Doctors of the class of 22, I understand this has been a most unusual time for both your education and your entry into the profession. But you're special people, you're bright and ambitious, with great minds and even greater hearts. Don't lose sight of that. Celebrate your accomplishments, celebrate your new profession, but mostly celebrate each other and those close to you. Doctors of the class of 2022, I extend my heartfelt congratulations to you, and I wish you success and happiness in both your personal and professional lives. Audience, and this is the last time, so let's make it a good one. Please congratulate these graduates of the School of Dental Medicine, the year 2022. So this concludes today's ceremony. I'd ask that the audience please remain at your seats for the recessional of the platform party, faculty, and graduates in that order. Following the recessional, we ask that you meet guests outside and meet your graduate. Platform guests, faculty, and graduates, please stand to begin the recessional.